you planets full of bullshit. Jim Sterling here, and this is No Man's Sky. It's that game you may have heard about, the one that made everyone upset before it had even come out on a store shelf. I don't know. Either way, it's more or less out now, and then we can move on with our lives, thank God. So this is it. This is the game after much anticipation, much hype, much waiting, much controversy, many death threats even, delays and street date breakages and arguments about reviews and questions over whether the game's only 30 hours long and just all of that bullshit. And this is what it comes down to. A big dinosaur squirrel. That's really what it's all about. It's a dinosaur squirrel. Yep, there it goes. It's got a smiley face above its head. It's happy because I fed it some metal. That's what they eat on this planet. This planet's called Chungus, by the way. The animals eat iron that you get from rocks. See there, just feeding it some iron. And now that one's happy as well. The weird platypus rat with pilot fish lights. So that's good. The animals are very Lego animal-y. You soon learn that once you've been on a few inhabited planets. They are various bits and pieces of animals thrown together. It does create a fairly decent illusion of alien life. When you go on another planet, you see familiar bits, but so long as you suspend your disbelief, it's easy to not think of them as mix and match Lego creatures. Sometimes. But you get your squirrel dinosaurs, so that's all that matters, really. They're kind of adorable in a hideous way. Yeah. If you feed them enough stuff and they like you, you get some gold. Not just gold, you get all sorts of interesting things. Anyway, this is my spaceship, getting in that now. Takes off. You fly around in it. If you've seen any of the previews of No Man's Sky, which no doubt you have, then... Oh, that's my phone. I should mute that, really, if I'm going to do a video. Hey, there we are. That's muted. Right, back to business. Here we are. This is basically what the game is. There's a loose series of goals and objectives, but basically you land on a planet, and then you go around the planet, going to the little green question marks to open up little waypoints and things. There you go, so you claimed a sector. And then when you discovered the sector, you can name it. So, I haven't bothered naming individual sectors, but we are in the system Chungus, and it's full of planets called Chungus, which is, well, it was amusing to me for a few minutes anyway. As far as opinion on the game goes, it's, well, I don't hate it. If you like fiddling around with your inventory and crafting, and basically, if you like a lot of bog-standard survival games, then this is for you. It's not as obnoxious as many survival games out there. You've not got to bother eating and drinking all the time, but there is some survival management. You've got to constantly get carbon to fill up your survival meter, your, that's not really the word, your survival meter, but you've basically got a suit that allows you to withstand the different environments, and you got to fill that up with carbon. And you've got your mining gun that you use to blow up rocks and trees and things to get your carbon and your iron and all that. And that needs to be filled with other materials. And it's just a lot of materials. You get materials to fill your things, to get more materials, to make things that often take the other materials. So it's a lot of just materials and crafting and that sort of thing. And you start off with a limited inventory that, as you saw a moment ago, you can fill up as you go on. So that's basically it. It's a lot of filling up things with things so that you can go to things to do more things, to fill up more things, to do more things. That's your starting spaceship. It's crap. I eventually traded that in. You can trade them in. There's sentient life out there. Various planets have little stations. Not huge. You never get the sense that, at least in my gameplay so far, I've never gotten the sense that there's anything densely populated. You just see the occasional solo NPC here and there that's just stood there. I think one of the things that really hammers that home is there's some footage later on where you get to a space station and you see lots of spaceships come in and land, and you can interact with the spaceship to talk to the pilot, but it's not like they get out and go to the trading post or do anything. There's a lot of, I mean, I said earlier, suspension of disbelief. To really get yourself immersed in this, you've really got to buy into that and not see just how static and staged a lot of the stuff is, which isn't a huge problem necessarily. If you get into it, then that's fine. I think that's kind of helped by the choose your own adventure style narrative that crops up. Various NPC interactions, various storyline things. It's just presented to you with big boxes of text and you choose a response. And that kind of, even though that should take you out of it, it actually makes the rest of it more bearable, because you just think to yourself, okay, this is it's a survival game with choose your own adventure elements. And so long as you're not expecting, what I think some people are expecting, which is, you know, this giant universe of pure, unbridled imagination, where dynamic excitement is happening at every turn, so long as you're not expecting the moon to, you know, if you excuse the spacefaring phrase, then you'll be all right with it. So this is going from off-planet out into space, which, again, like, it's, I don't know, I don't feel like I'm in some huge universe, you know? It feels like I'm in a, it feels very video gamey, which is a bit of an odd criticism because it is a video game. But I think you know what I mean. The planets and the different systems and that, there's just, it just doesn't feel like there's a lot going on, you know? I mean, that's me shooting some meteors. At least one thing to the game's credit is different fuel and things like that are sensibly placed. When you're on a planet, you typically need a lot of carbon to keep yourself going, and it's very easy to find. You need Themium 9 for basic ship fuel, and as you can see, we're just raking it in here. And there are various, you know, different things are more readily available in different systems and stuff like that. Really is a shitty spaceship, that one. The one I eventually got, it wasn't particularly better than the one I've got, you know, Chungus, but it looked like an insect with TIE fighter panels on the side, so obviously I went for it. Anyway, this is warp travel. This is going from system to system, in the different regions. The yellow path seems to be that your particular journey towards the center of the universe, which is that overarching goal. So this is what it looks like to travel at warp speed. We're going FTL from Chungus to a new undiscovered region, and it takes a fair bit. That's another thing to really get used to in this game, is getting anywhere takes a fair bit. And unlike, you know, unlike a more typical open world game, there's not a lot to do from point A to point B. As you can see, we are just, I mean, this could very well be hiding loading, but it still takes a fair old bit. We get there eventually. Here we are in the system Vart Savoy, which again, if you discover it, you can rename it. I could rename that to anything I want. To be honest, the novelty of that wears off quickly. Once you've made a system called Chungus and called all the planets in it Chungus, I'm all right just uploading my discoveries and just getting the credits for it. Every time you upload a discovery, you get credits. This was my first experience with space combat, which I hate. I don't actually like the combat in this game at all. Various planets have sentinels on them, which are bad robots, I suppose, and it's not that fun. The first person shooting on planet is a bit, I mean, it's all right. It's not terrible. It's if it were a, if this game were a first-person shooter, and it didn't have all the other stuff, then based on the FPS mechanics we have, it would be a terrible FPS. It's a good job it has everything else, you know. Anyway, that's enough of that. We don't need to know how that space combat ends. Needless to say, well, considering we're flying towards my grave here, needless to say, that combat didn't go well. That was my first experience with space combat. I basically tried to run away, but you can't run away because they will just shoot you down. So you've got to stand and fight. But so far, I've not quite nailed down keeping a bead on them. They move very fast, and I can't seem to just keep them in my sights. So generally, I try and avoid where possible. This mitigates some of how, you know, how long it can take to get to somewhere. You've got that pulse speed thing that lets you get to a planet or a space station, as we're seeing here, very quickly, which is good. That you don't have to manually travel at a slow pace the whole time. There are different speeds. You've basically got a cruise speed, you've got a boost speed, you've got your pulse speed that we just saw there, and of course if you want to go from region to region, you've got your warp speed. Which takes, you know, it all takes different kinds of fuel, which again is different resource gathering, different inventory management, different crafting in some cases, such as the case of traveling faster than light. So this is an NPC interaction. This is a Gek, one of the several sentient alien races. Now, you see the subtitle on the left there, you can't understand what they say. There's a language system in the game as you find new aliens, and as you find new... There are different like monoliths and monuments and things on different planets. You can learn different words, and you can kind of learn what each species likes. There's another alien race I found called the Vickers or something like that. They like carbon. These guys, they're like a merchant race. They like units. I mean, who doesn't love a good unit? And as you see what I mean about the choose your own adventure stuff, you know, you get these various different things you can... different interactions you can choose. And that'll determine different things. And... your interactions with each different alien race will improve your reputation with each one. And so far that's the bit I found most interesting, even though, as I say, the NPCs feel quite static. I do enjoy meeting new ones. If only because it's something that feels a bit less stark in this universe. It is a big universe full of kind of repetitive tasks, so at least when you find an NPC, that's something a bit different to do. But this is a galactic trading post. We sell that gold we got off the dinosaur squirrels, and we can buy and sell different things. I was selling all sorts of random crap, and I was ignoring my main objectives just because I wanted a different spaceship. Because one thing you learn quickly is getting a starship with a bigger inventory is just going to be much better for you in the long run, because inventories fill up so quick in this game. I mean, like, within the first 5 minutes of the game, I was filling my stuff up pretty damn quick. So getting as many units as possible and then finding a bigger, better starship and buying them. Pretty much everyone I've found so far is up for sale, and I've found a fair few starships landing around the place, and they've all been potentially up for sale. You know, they get fairly expensive, but it doesn't take much. So long as you go on a planet and do a fair bit of collecting and find some more rare resources, you can get a spaceship pretty quickly. That's just as we head out here, we should see other spaceships coming down. There's one landing there, you see. And like I say, you can interact with any one of those, but it's not like you see, or at least so far, I've not seen any aliens come out of them and behave as if, you know, they're living and breathing in the world. They pop up like this. That's like, gives it a very adventure game feel rather than a dynamic universe feel. And this, I don't buy this ship, but I'm just sort of showing off what you can potentially do here. So you can buy and sell things directly to the pilot, or you can make an offer on the ship itself. You just got to be aware that if you don't transfer various items from your ship to the new ship, you will lose them. It'll just become part of the deal. I do like the alien designs, though. The Gek here, these sort of weird beaked frog things with the fun goggles. Like, I really love that design. I've come across... there's a new one I came across. I don't think I included it in this video, but they basically all look like Daft Punk. They're these strange robotic life forms with visors, and they all look like they're in Daft Punk. The Vickers, or whatever they're called, like really Viskers, maybe. God, I can't remember their name. But they look very Star Warsy. It's just me looking around at all the different ship designs. A ton of them out there. Like I say, they're all yours for the taking if you've got the money for them. It does look cool as you sort of go in and out of things. So one of my favourite things to do is to go in and out of a space station, because I find them very entertaining. And this is us heading down towards a planet. This one is an oceanic planet and a nuclear planet as well. Each planet has its own environment and different hazards. There's some planets that have storms on them. There are ice planets. I hit my microphone as I usually do. This one is very watery planet. And there are actual objectives and things under the water. So that's fun. One thing that I do like about the game is that despite how samey a lot of the environmental details look, the colour schemes give them a very different flavour each. So it gives a good, again, like the animals, it gives a good illusion of things being a bit more varied than they actually are. It's always worth going into places like this, by the way. Sort of almost every building you can go into has something you can collect. And I really like just some of the weird colour schemes they have, like this planet in particular. The deep red sky and the green and purple floors and things. Whole planet looks like a bruiser bar. Which I've been informed reliably they still sell in the UK for 40p. I think that's what the comment said, 40p, when I last mentioned bruiser bars. Apparently they still sell refresher bars and whopper bars as well. Bar-based confectionery is always fun. This is Heridian. It defies the laws of physics because you can shoot it from the bottom up and it'll just then just be a big rock that's floating in the sky. Which again is another thing that made me realise the game just really is very Builder Block. Builder Planet Workshop. It's not like there's anything that feels all that dynamic. It's not like you could blast the bottom of this rock out and the rest of it would tumble with some sort of physics engine, you know? You could shoot it out and it's just chunks floating in the air. Which, again, you can explain away with, well, it's alien magic stuff. But, you know, you see here. Does look a bit silly, even if you could explain it with science fiction. Well, that's just me. So yeah, I'm gonna clearly need more time with it. This is obviously just a first impressions video. I've spent basically most of the afternoon with it before I recorded this, and I'm sure I'll have played a bit more between now and here. Well, between me recording this and you seeing the video. And before I do the review, of course, I'll be spending a lot more time with it. But right now, I feel like, I know I don't want to say it, but I've been on several planets, I've been in several systems, and I don't feel like there's any surprise left for me, you know? I don't feel like I'm going to stumble across any big revelation. It's another thing I don't like about the game from a graphical standpoint, is you see the way it fades details in. I've seen a few games do this, not many, but I've seen a couple of games do this, where rather than just do the standard pop-in, the standard fade-in of environmental details, it does it with this strange grainy quality. And I don't know if developers think that doing that makes it less conspicuous, because it's a bit different from what we're used to, but it really doesn't. I should, of course, point out I'm on the PS4 version. I'm using a review copy there. And, yeah. I'm sure it's better on PC, visually. But that... I've never been a fan of that grainy pop-in. I'd rather just have a very standard fade-in. But anyway, we're going to go in the water, because there was a little objective under the water, and I wanted to go look at it. Of course, it's a very dangerous thing to do, because not only is there the, you know, an oxygen meter to worry about, the radiation increases in the water, because that's how it works. The game bugs you a lot with its objectives. You can see them in the corner there. Craft more warp cells for hyperdrive, which I have done by now, but anyway, pop down here, there we go, had to make it work. Tribute to Edanimulco, and that tells you a thing there. Look upon our works in despair, some sort of plaque to the Gek, those unassuming merchant frogs with the beaks. And then it hints that there's something maybe a bit darker there. Mystery. Ooh. So yeah, that's No Man's Sky, basically. It's alright so far. I'll be honest, I'm not that excited about it. I mean, fair play to you if you are, and you end up playing it and adoring it and finding it, you know, encapsulating. But so far it hasn't grabbed me by the bollocks. It hasn't really grabbed me at all. Just kind of a bit on it. Oh well, back in the ship. New planets to discover, eh? Yeah.